Hello, and welcome to the James Bond Countdown, the series where I, a lifelong 007 fan, bring you ranked lists pertaining to every last aspect of the James Bond film franchise. Today I'm ranking what is perhaps the single most iconic visual associated with the franchise, the gun barrel. On the surface, it might seem like a rather trivial element of the film. It is less than a minute of screen time, after all. But any 007 fan will tell you that the gun barrel is just as important to Bond as the opening title crawl is to Star Wars. It welcomes you into that world. The second those white dots dance across the screen, the adrenaline starts pumping. And if the gun barrel has done its job, you're already thrilled by the time that iris opens up into the first shot. But ranking the gun barrels actually proves quite difficult. For the first 30 to 40 years of the franchise, the differences between gun barrels were really very negligible. In fact, the only major difference between most of them is the music, which makes it difficult to do a gun barrel ranking that isn't just a gun barrel music ranking. So I had to establish a criteria for myself, a checklist of what I want in a gun barrel, from the animation and design of the barrel itself, to the shade and speed of the blood drip, from the arrangement and tempo of the music, to the pace and pose of the actor. And doing that made me realize there might not be one that checks every single box. Different gun barrels have different strengths, so all I can do is weigh those strengths to pinpoint the gun barrel that I feel is strongest overall. That being said, I still hesitate to commit to the exact order of this list. It would almost be easier to group them into categories than to assign each one a numbered rank. But this channel is called the James Bond Countdown, so that's what I'm gonna do. This is a top 10. I think it's safe to say that the Live and Let Die gun barrel is an all-time favorite for Bond fans across the board. I've always loved the gun barrels that featured a new sound for a new decade, and George Martin certainly gave Roger Moore's Bond a sound for the 70s. This arrangement of the Bond theme is groovy, funky, and even bluesy, but it still has that badass Bondian guitar at the heart of it. However, the reason it doesn't place any higher for me is because it doesn't really check any boxes outside of the music. I've never been big on the two-handed poses Roger did for his gun barrels, and I think the barrel itself could have used a fresh color palette rather than just pulling the original black and white reference. And this might be an unpopular opinion, but I'm actually not crazy about the big extended flourish as the iris opens up. I liken it to when the Bond theme is blaring as Connery searches his room in From Russia with Love. It's a great piece of music, but it doesn't really fit here. Maybe it would work if we were opening on something like an impressive villain lair, but I just think it's excessive for a relatively mundane establishing shot of an ordinary city. I think it even would have been better if they'd just used the ending from the full version of this particular Bond theme arrangement, which I've taken the liberty of testing. The Thunderball gun barrel is notable for a few reasons. One, it was the first time the actor playing Bond was actually the one inside the gun barrel. Two, it was the first gun barrel to be presented in a glorious widescreen aspect ratio. And three, it was the first gun barrel to feature the iris opening into the first shot of the movie. Put it all together, and there's no denying that Thunderball set the visual standard for all gun barrels to follow. On top of that, it features a great up-tempo arrangement of the classic Bond theme, the blood is a strong, rich red, and the opening shot of a coffin marked JB makes for an intriguing hook. I like Connery's stride, as well as his final pose, but the actual moment that he turns has always felt kinda jittery to me, almost like he's trying not to lose his balance. But overall, this is a quintessential classic. The Diamonds Are Forever gun barrel has always been one of my absolute favorites from a visual standpoint. I love the shimmery light effect that they projected over top of it. Not only is it fitting for a story centered around diamonds, but it also infuses an otherwise static graphic with a sense of color and movement. I wish they had tried more effects like this over the years to keep things looking fresh and exciting. It could have been a great way to give each actor their own distinct gun barrel. John Barry's arrangement of the theme here features a slower tempo than most, but not too slow, perfect for tapping your foot to, and it's the last time we get to hear that classic twang in the guitar riff. The blood once again looks perfect, and the first shot is fantastic. What better moment to open on than Bond throwing a guy through a wall? But still, there is one thing about this gun barrel that's always puzzled me. In spite of Connery's gun barrel footage being shot in color, as we see in Thunderball, for some reason they chose to make it black and white in You Only Live Twice and Diamonds Are Forever. It doesn't bother me per se, but I have always wondered about it. The For Your Eyes Only gun barrel is undoubtedly a fan favorite, and rightfully so. Just as the Live and Let Die gun barrel ushered in a new sound for the 70s, this one certainly did so for the 80s. John Barry used roughly the same arrangement of the Bond theme for every gun barrel that he scored between Man with the Golden Gun and Living Daylights. It's an orchestral rendition most easily identified as the Roger Moore Bond theme, but there were two films during that time which Barry did not score, and both offered refreshing alternatives for their respective gun barrels. In the case of For Your Eyes Only, Bill Conti's score delivers a badass disco-sounding arrangement that's heavy on the horns, and the cowbell.
You're gonna want that cowbell from the track.
The opening notes in particular really grab your attention in a big, bold way. Outside of the music, I love the design of the gun barrel here. It has a very pale blue tinge to it that's different enough to be noticeable, but not so different that it looks wrong. The blood is a nice bright red, and I love the smash cut to the first shot rather than having the iris open in the usual fashion. It's not something I think would work every time, but when paired with this particular music, it really kicks ass. The Spy Who Loved Me features the other gun barrel that provided a break from Barry's orchestral arrangements, but where Bill Conti's score is loud and dramatic, Marvin Hamlisch's is sly and understated, forgoing the traditional opening notes and jumping straight into the underlying four-note motif of the Bond theme. And as much as I love the gun barrel themes of Live and Let Die and For Your Eyes Only, they do sound distinctly 70s and 80s, whereas this score has a considerably more timeless sound to it for the most part. The tempo is a little bit too fast for my money, but I love the slightly deeper sound of the main guitar riff. Visually, this is more or less the same design that we see for the next 12 years of the franchise, though I do think the blood actually might be a bit darker than usual. Before I move on, there is one thing that has always bothered me about this gun barrel, and it's how the last note of the music does not sync up with the iris opening, especially because it's off by less than a second. Just watch how much more satisfying it is once they're synced up. There are many elements of the Brosnan era that get a lot of flack from both fans and casual viewers of the franchise, but his gun barrels have never been one of those elements. In fact, I think most fans would agree that he has the best-looking gun barrels in the history of the series. The updated 3D animation by Daniel Kleinman is so beautiful. It has this reflective, watery, funhouse mirror kind of look while it's in motion, and then a gorgeously polished update on the original design once Bond poses. Speaking of which, Brosnan's walk and pose, while not my favorite, both carry an undeniable level of confidence. Visually, all four of Brosnan's gun barrels are practically identical, which might make it seem frivolous to place any one above the others, but GoldenEye has a couple key advantages for me. First is the music. Eric Serra's blend of percussion, synth, and strings just has this inherent spy sound to it. And I love David Arnold, but I've never been crazy about his gun barrel arrangements. Two of them used the ascending climax of the Bond theme rather than the main riff, which doesn't really get my blood pumping, and the third has all these crazy drums in the background that just make it sound too busy. The other advantage I give this gun barrel over Brosnan's others is the opening shot. You simply can't beat the scope and scale of that plane flying over the dam. Overall, this remains the standard for a modern gun barrel in my mind. Everything about the Casino Royale gun barrel from conception to execution is absolutely brilliant. This is the story of Bond becoming the Bond we know, so it made perfect sense not to open it with a traditional gun barrel. The pre-title sequence is Bond earning his 00 status, and in so doing, he earns the gun barrel as we head into the opening titles. I love the timing of Bond delivering his last line, then picking up the gun, and the cutaway to the bad guy finally leading us into the classic pose. Speaking of which, as much as I love the way that Craig spins and shoots, it's always kind of nagged at me that you can't see his other arm in the final pose, just because it makes him look like an amputee if you freeze frame it. But that nitpick aside, I love the design of this gun barrel. It's not a look that I think could ever become the standard, but it's a perfect fit for this movie. It almost resembles the kinds of patterns you would see in a casino, such as a roulette wheel. And that's of course no mistake, because the title sequence that follows is full of that imagery. I also love how you see the reflections of Bond and the bathroom tile in the gun barrel. And of course I have to mention the combined timing of the music, blood drip, and pulling away from the iris further down the barrel. The only real drawback for me is how fast it's over, but that's really just a testament to how much I love it. Along with Casino Royale, Dr. No is of course the other film with a gun barrel that transitions into the opening titles, but there are a couple of things that give it a slight edge for me. One being that it includes a full walk into the turn, and the other that it's accompanied by the James Bond theme. Nothing against You Know My Name, but as a gun barrel, I have to give points to the Bond theme. Visually, the first three Bond films essentially used the exact same gun barrel featuring stuntman Bob Simmons, but the atmosphere of this gun barrel is unmatched. The electronic beeping sounds foreshadowing Dr. No's control room are such an inspired choice, and the prolonged silence as the gunshot rings out makes the explosion of the music that much more impactful. Surprisingly, I don't mind the hop that Bob Simmons does, but I've never much cared for how off-center his final pose is. And while I do think it took them a few films to get just the right shade of red for the blood, the design of that original barrel is as perfect as it is iconic. All in all, the atmosphere and the timing of this one do so much to get me pumped for the movie that follows. Alright, so I really agonized over this one. As I mentioned mere moments ago, it is visually identical to the previous two films, so naturally I have all the same visual notes that I just listed for Dr. No. And yet, I couldn't imagine ranking it any lower on this list, let alone leaving it off entirely. In fact, I even debated giving it the number one slot. It's very close. And as much as I didn't want this ranking to be all about the music, my ranking of this one is all about the music. As far as I'm concerned, Goldfinger has hands down the greatest arrangement of the gun barrel cue in the whole franchise. The drum hits on the opening notes, the steady clatter of the cymbals, the strings singing that four-note motif, and the guitar perfectly plucking that main riff, all at just the right tempo. The title of this piece on the soundtrack is Bond Back in Action Again, and boy does it give off that energy. This is the sound of excitement and escapism. The second I hear it, my adrenaline starts pumping and my mind starts racing at the thought of the adventure I'm about to be thrust into. But it doesn't overstay its welcome. Barry skillfully brings it to a soothing lull as we're transported into the quiet nighttime setting of Bond's clandestine infiltration. This is how you score a gun barrel. There are a few key things that factor into License to Kill being my personal favorite gun barrel. To start, Michael Kamen's score is nothing short of epic. I'd equate it to what Lauren Balfe did with the Mission Impossible theme for Fallout. It has this fateful urgency about it. The way those opening notes sort of roll into and over each other gives me chills every time. And the score only grows more ominous and dramatic as the iris opens up, teasing a dark and dangerous story ahead of us. I also love how the orchestra and the guitar play the main riff in unison. It beautifully melds both of the gun barrel arrangements that John Barry had previously established. From a visual standpoint, the barrel design and blood drip are essentially the same as they'd been since Spy Who Loved Me, but in my opinion, Dalton gives the strongest gun barrel performance of any actor to ever walk, turn, and shoot. His stride is so confident, his spin is so smooth, and his final pose is so dramatic, almost like he's ready to charge towards the barrel and tackle the poor bloke who he just shot. It's a commanding presence that's perfectly in line with how he played the role itself. If I have one complaint, it's maybe that the transition from Dalton to the first shot is a little abrupt, but I do love that first shot. You can't go wrong opening a Bond film on an exotic vista. I think a lot of the gun barrels on this list have checked an equal number of boxes for me, but ultimately it comes down to the cumulative quality of those elements rather than the quantity of them. And when I think about the gun barrel that gets me most excited for the movie I'm about to see, License to Kill takes the cake every time. Well, there you have it, my top 10 favorite gun barrels. Please do jump down into the comments and share your personal favorites. I'm willing to bet this is consistently one of the more difficult things for fans to rank. I even rearranged a few of them as I was making this video. As always, don't forget to subscribe so that you never miss a countdown.